Hi, this is Steve Hopkins, and this is Pong Now, an interview series talking table tennis with some of the best players and personalities in the sport. Today, I have Hall of Famer Mitch Seidenfeld. He was, a 2300 level player, a longtime organizer, a coach, a large part of the Minnesota table tennis scene, and honestly, probably worthy of an interview without doing any discussion about Paralympics or all of the titles and disabilities and being a little person. How you doing, Mitch?
I'm good, Steve. Nice to be here.
So let's start there so that I don't stumble over words and you know, offend lots of Americans. So you played in Paralympics. You are a para athlete. Explain what makes you a para athlete.
Well, a big part of it is my dwarfism. I have a type of dwarfism called pseudoachondroplasia, and it creates a lot of orthopedic problems in my legs and hips, also the shoulders and the length of arms. So my my arms and legs are short in proportion to my upper body. When I first started playing in the Paralympic table tennis, it was mainly because of leg disability. That was the class I was put into. They don't have a class for people with dwarfism. So,
and what class is that?
I was originally put in class 8 out of the 10 classes at that time. So it was a standing disabled class where people had leg disability for the most part. And then when I took a couple years break after I had my hips replaced, and when I came back, I was surprised to find out that they no longer had a class for little people. They didn't even consider us disabled anymore. So they put me in class 10, which was the least disabled class, where it's considered minimal disability. And until they could reevaluate where people with dwarfism might belong. And then 2 years later, they discovered that I didn't belong in the least disabled class and put me in class 7. So that's where I stayed. But as you know, my son also competes and he's in class 6 and he's very similar in body type to me. So I think if I were classified right now, I'd probably go into class 6 or 7.
All right, so I'm just curious, 2300 level play is way up there. How did you do in class 10?
Well, my best show, I only competed in one world championships while I was in class 10, and I was one game away from medaling. I was playing a very good player from Sweden that was about a 25-50 player. And I beat him the first two games, but at the time my shoulder was quite bad. I couldn't really finish when I got pop-ups, and he was good enough that he kind of pulled himself together, and because he was terrified that he was going to lose to me. He's about 6 feet tall and he's a looper off both sides and played in the first division Swedish league, and he pulled himself together with his coach's help, and I just couldn't finish when I got him to pop up balls. I couldn't finish hard enough. So, but if I would have won that, I would have won a bronze medal in class 10. And I won a bronze medal in the Pan American Games in class 10. So I was fairly competitive, but that's not where I belong though.
Yeah. Your class, the one you dominated in was class 8, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And you had maybe a 7 or 8 year run where you were number one in the world?
Correct. Yes.
How many tournaments do you think you won over that 8 year period?
You know, at that time there weren't that many, there wasn't like a tour of para tournaments. So to stay there, I simply won the world championships in 1990. I won the Paralympics in 1992. And then there were a couple invitational tournaments between 92 and 94. I didn't lose in class 8. And then I competed in the Atlanta Paralympics in 96 and I got a silver medal. at the time I had a broken hip, so I didn't know it, but it was broken and it was very painful. So there was a good Swedish player that kind of moved me around and I wasn't able to win at that time. So I still retain the number one ranking because I had enough other wins throughout the tournament where he didn't overtake me.
Yeah. All right. So let's go backwards. Your 8-year run was 1990 to 98. When did you start playing?
When did I start playing?
Yes.
In the Paralympic type tournaments
So I should do a better job of asking questions. When did you move from being somebody who played with your dad, and played locally to being somebody who people, you know, knew and saw at tournaments? When did you become a real solid tournament player?
Boy, I started playing at an organized club in 1976. I was 13 years old. My father and I had played at home for a couple years in our basement, kind of following Dick Miles' Sports Illustrated book, and that's how we learned our strokes. But by the time I was in college in 1981, I think I was recognized on the national level, or even a couple years earlier by the time I was 17 or 18, but I was still maybe a 2000 level player. I wasn't anywhere near the 2300 that I eventually got to. And a big part of that getting to 2300 had more to do with how I viewed myself as a player. I think early on, I was just trying to keep up with people and have fun. I had friends that were in the game. So we had a great club, and some of my best friends were my table tennis friends. But once it wasn't until I got involved in the disabled table tennis that I was able to kind of see myself on a podium and started to say, oh, I actually am good, you know, around the world. And once I did that, I was able to go back to Minnesota and actually win the Minnesota state championship 5 times. But up until then, we had a couple really good players. I'm not sure you're familiar, and a lot of the viewers might not know Brandon Olson, but he made the 1987 world team for the U.S., and so I always had a top player living in Minnesota, and kind of he kept me from, I was always number 2 or 3 in Minnesota. But once I said I'm world champion, it didn't seem a far stretch to be Minnesota state champion too.
How much were you playing each day, jumping from 2000 to 2300?
I never have played more than 2 or 3 hours a day. I don't have the kind of body that can do those camps and where you do 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the afternoon. Yep. So at most I would do an hour to 2 hours of training. But I would go to the club for round robin days and play all day long, maybe play 6 to 10 matches. But there was never the intense 6-hour days that some people are doing now. Yeah. So 1 or 2 hours a day, maybe 3 days a week.
Okay. Let's talk Minnesota a little bit. So did you grow up in Minnesota?
I moved to Minnesota when I was 10. In 1972. And so I've lived here for, almost 50 years. Yeah.
And you mentioned in our conversation ahead of this that Table Tennis Minnesota was something that you had founded and worked with, and that now there's Minnesota Table Tennis Federation. So talk a little bit about those two organizations.
Yes, early in the 1990s, I was a little frustrated with the development of the sport in Minnesota, and I made it one of my goals to kind of form an organization. I thought we needed to do more, something more organized than just have a club where we could all play and have fun. And so I started by doing community education courses with Phi Ed teachers. It was all actually started with Richard McAfee and Scott Price had done a national schools program. And I was invited to go be part of that, be one of the initial coaches that would get trained in. And it gave me sort of a package of something to teach with Phi-Ed teachers during in-service programs. And that led to having access to some of those schools where I could run a league or a clinic. And that was the beginning of it. And it was done outside of the actual club atmosphere. I just thought our clubs had always been in inner city Minneapolis, and it was really difficult to get women and kids to come be part of the club. Yep. I think that still is the case in some places around the country, that we can't really afford the kind of space that attractive to women and kids, you know, and parents to bring their kids to. So that was the beginning of it, with doing community ed courses and getting access to schools to be able to run beginner leagues for people that were really making that jump from recreational play to the organized club. And there's a big jump to do that.
Give me an idea of numbers there. How many folks were you dealing with early on?
Well, I was still working my job, so I did this in my spare time, but I might do one clinic a month where I could get maybe 10 to 15 physical education teachers from a particular school district. And I maybe do that once every month for a couple years. So we probably trained in somewhere between 100 and 200 Phi-Ed teachers to at least be able to teach table tennis as a actual sport in their Phi-Ed units or their racket sports units. And it was through those contacts that it enabled me to start running programs at schools. I also worked through the University of Minnesota. That was where I was. I went to school. And so it was still part-time, but it got the ball moving on what would become kind of a club without walls. I didn't really want to have a club where I had a rent payment every month, and I would work with these community centers and schools to run leagues closer to where people lived, instead of expecting them all to come to a central location in the worst part of South Minneapolis kind of thing. You know?
How many players do you think you guys managed to touch each year during that time?
Well, several hundred each year. I mean, now we have thousands that are playing in Minnesota. Due to those leagues, we also eventually got into Lifetime Fitness Health Club. It wasn't called that in the beginning. It was a big tennis and racket club in Minnesota. They had 10 or 12 really big tennis centers, and I was able to get table tennis into three of those clubs. That also helped us get to people that had the financial means to get their kids involved and bring them to tournaments, things like that. And it gave me access to their gyms for running round robin days and other leagues. And then eventually our state high school tournament has become the next big way to get to thousands of kids, because we have about 30 high schools that are involved in the high school championships. And each one of those schools has a club in their school of anywhere from 10 to sometimes 60 kids participating, depending on how many tables they have and how serious they take it.
It's enviable. We need to figure out how to bottle you and send you out to 49 other states.
It's tough anywhere you go, but I was fortunate that table tennis had actually dwindled in Minnesota back in the early 90s, and it gave me a chance to almost mold it the way I thought it should be. It is a lot tougher when you're in a city where there's other clubs and there's so much competition. I was able to kind of create it the way I thought it should be, and it worked out pretty well.
Mm-hmm. All right, so was all of that under Table Tennis Minnesota's banner? What is Minnesota Table Tennis Federation, or is that all kind of the same concept?
Now we're joined together. Originally, I formed Table Tennis Minnesota so that I didn't have to ask anybody for money or to do anything. I just did it all on my own with the help of a few friends that were great volunteers, people that they were all professionals, but they weren't professional table tennis players. So we had human resource directors and electrical engineers and computer programmers and one karate martial arts pro and master. And so they had a unique set of skills that helped us run tournaments and run leagues. And they also understood the importance of not just playing all the time. Now that's a big problem in the United States, is that we all know that the very thing that makes table tennis so cool for us is that we can compete our whole lives and even keep getting better until you're in your, you know, late years. But that also becomes a big problem when you're trying to run programs and you have no volunteers. You know, everybody's enjoying moving their rating up from 1500 to 1543. Yep. Instead of running a league that satisfies the playing needs of 40 or 60 new players. So that was the kind of the battle, but we had some really great volunteers here in Minnesota, and we still do. So it started as Table Tennis Minnesota, a for-profit business that didn't make any money originally. Then as it got bigger, it reached a point where I couldn't make it any bigger on my own. And so I felt joining it with the nonprofit organization where people would feel more comfortable volunteering and we could also raise funds and donations. Whereas I was just doing it all with the money that I pulled in through league fees or coaching fees. And I would just put that back into buying more tables and forming more leagues. So now that the two organizations work together.
All right. So, but before we end, let me ask this one. Where are you going to be 5 years or 10 years from now? What's next?
Well, I'm getting old and I was really burnt out the last couple of years, but I'm getting a little resurgence or a rebirth. It's hard to say. My son is kind of my main focus right now. He's qualified for Tokyo Paralympics, as long as that ends up going on. So right now that's my biggest goal and direction.
So is that dad as promoter or dad as coach?
Right now I'm actually the national team coach for the Paralympic team. So we have three players. We have Tal Leibovitz and Jensen Van Emberg plays in a wheelchair. And then Ian is the third. And it's an exciting team because they all have a chance at a medal in Tokyo. So yeah, for the foreseeable future, that's the main thing. But 5 years from now, I'm just hoping that more people in Minnesota work with me to kind of keep moving things forward and that it can kind of go on without me. I did work with Butterfly before 2010. Bowie Martin also saw the importance of leagues and I also view junior programs kind of along with it, junior programs and beginner leagues as the key to building the sport. But he saw that back then. And so we were trying to encourage other states to do the same thing. And a lot of the big clubs have seen the importance of running leagues. You know, you see it at Samson Dubina's club and you see it at ICC out in Milpitas. And so it's exciting because those were people I talked to back then and was encouraging them to start running leagues and junior programs. So it's going in the right direction.
All right. Well, that's probably a good place to bring this to a close. You know, honestly, I hadn't read a lot about you as a player, but I am familiar with a lot of you as a promoter and some of these other things that you've been doing. It's two very interesting elements of you. They're probably both Hall of Fame worthy, you know, independent of the other, but, let's plan on having this conversation again sometime. Okay.
I would love to. Thanks for having me, Steve.
Yeah. Thank you very much.